people. Don't mind the orange thing.
So strange.
Oh my god, that's the weirdest thing. It's the weirdest thing we've ever seen.
It's like it's forming like an L if you look at it the other way.
I wonder if the people in the airplane can see
it. I wonder if they're aliens. They're out of space.
It's so weird. It's just hovering.
It shoots us an L.
Cloud rises over 7 miles.
Ahead of me. I'm trying to close in for a better look. Here is the real flying saucer story. You will see with your own eyes actual motion pictures of flying saucers. Scenes that were stamped top secret by the Pentagon. These films have never before been shown to the general press and public. These men are about to see actual motion pictures of flying saucers. You will see them too.
Roswell, New Mexico, 1947. A military town and Air Force base.
home to America's 509 bomb group, a tight-knit community of soldiers and civilians in the heartland of rural America. In the summer of 1947, the whole of America was gripped by a wave of sightings of flying saucers. In Roswell, there were many witnesses to a strange light in the sky. Radio networks issued hourly bulletins. This is an actual broadcast of the time.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army. Army officers say the missile, found sometime last week, has been inspected at Roswell, New Mexico, and sent to Wright Field, Ohio, for further inspection. Russia has demanded UN action to get all...
Major Marcel had flown samples of the material to Fort Worth, Texas, headquarters of the 8th Air Force. Here, the story would take a remarkable turn. General Roger Ramey, the commanding officer there, called a press conference in his office. In front of photographers, he invited Major Marcel to display the material he had brought from Roswell. The base duty weather officer was also ordered to attend so that he could give his verdict to the press as to precisely what Marcel was holding in his hands.
We're dealing with the biggest story of the millennium. This is the planet Earth by alien spacecraft. Successful cover-up of the best data, bodies and wreckage, for 58 years.
The bottom line is I don't believe the claim of the Air Force that all sightings can be explained.
This is the biggest secret in the history of the human race, and particularly in the history of modern government.
Dog 1 to Washington Control.
We are in the radar room at National Airport, Washington, D.C. on July 26, 1952. For the first time, unidentified flying objects have been sighted over the nation's capital.
I see them. They're all around me. They're moving in on me. They're coming closer. They're coming right at me.
Studies since 1958. That the evidence is overwhelming that planet Earth is being visited by intelligently controlled extraterrestrial spacecraft. In other words, some UFOs are alien spacecraft. Most are not. I don't care about those. Most isotopes aren't fissionable. I don't care about the ones that aren't if I want to build a reactor.
If somebody who had the clearance to carry nuclear weapons or launch nuclear weapons saw these objects over a nuclear facility and reported it and have documents to prove it happened, this is dispositive. That's what someone who is wanting to look into this, who says, well, could this really be true and I don't know about it?
But I realized at this point that it's very secret, that it was kept secret, because I asked him, what are you going to do with this piece of information? And he said, we always airbrush these out before we sell them to the public. So they're pesky little creatures appearing on this photograph they wanted to get rid of.
This is a fact of the matter. We were really not sure after John flew whether or not there were critters, living critters, out there somewhere.
Critters that were captured by NASA on that mission, the STS-75, in 1996. In all my considerable experience of the entire UFO scenario, I have never seen and never expected to see footage like that. And least of all did I expect to see it on film that or tape that had been exposed by the government in a NASA mission. The shuttle Columbia in this mission was equipped with a very sophisticated and expensive ultraviolet camera. It was sensitive to the near ultraviolet. And when they were up at 300 miles above the atmosphere, they launched from the Columbia a small satellite with a tether. Not long after it was launched from the Columbia, the tether broke. The tether, which is 12 miles long, straightens out into a long white line, which you can see as plainly as could be.
Columbia and the satellite now 77 nautical miles apart.
Now, while this is all going on, a whole covey of UFOs, perhaps three dozen of them, manifest to this ultraviolet camera, and they begin moving around, circulating, looking for all the world like something in an aquarium tank.
The satellite, again, just moving into sunrise.
Now, Houston, of course, down on the ground, is getting this feed from the Columbia, and they ask the astronauts in the shuttle, what can they see? What is it they can see?
Guys, getting the image?
Franklin, we see a long line, a couple of star-like things, and a lot of things swimming in the foreground. Can you describe what you're seeing?
Well, the long line is a tether, and there's a little bit of debris that kind of flies with us.
It is like a brilliant white bar. It looks like a neon sign, and it's 12 miles long. Now, what this does is give you a sort of cosmic ruler by which you can get an idea and an estimate of the diameter of the UFOs that are flitting around down there. Now, when you see them go behind the tether, that means that you can use that tether like a ruler to measure their diameter. And those things that are down there going behind the tether are between 2 and 3 nautical miles in diameter. One of the things you see over and over again is you see UFOs materialize into the ultraviolet while you watch. You see them come from out of nowhere to the point where they are returning a response to the camera. You also see them dematerialize while you have them under observation.
Now, 5, 6, 7 years ago, you know, I was going on the lecture, hey, you gotta listen to this, you gotta see what's going on. Now, I know they were right. I mean, mankind is not and will never be ready for this kind of information.
If we would get off of this ego trip, this Western scientific ego trip, we would not become the virus of the universe that we are. Nobody really wants us out there.
The dependence on oil could be ended overnight.
We're being slowly conditioned to understand that there is life outside this planet and that we probably live in a universe and a galaxy teeming with life.